around St. Patrick's Day. Yeah? Okay, thank you.
I guess we're ready. Good morning!
Good morning!
It's so good to have you all here this morning, those of you who are worshiping in person and those who are joining us on Facebook. To be with you, wonderful to have you here as we gather to praise and glorify our Father in heaven. A few announcements and things of interest going on. This morning, we are welcoming another new member. Tabitha Waters has decided to transfer her membership to Messiah from Luther Memorial. She's been worshiping with us since the fall, I do believe. She showed up at our doorstep one Sunday morning and hasn't stopped coming. So that's a good thing. Mm-hmm. You know, and she's already involved in the music ministry of the congregation, and she intends to get involved in other areas as well. So when you have a chance, maybe after service, outside or something, without congregating in large groups, welcome her personally to the congregation. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday. And being Palm Sunday, we read the Passion Narrative as a congregation. And so we need people to take on different parts of the Passion Narrative.
No, second service is taken care of.
Second service is great. Never mind then.
We only need Pontius Pilate and first service.
Great. Thank you. It wasn't full before, in between services. So thank you for signing up, those of you who did. Our Zoom Bible study will continue for two more weeks. Call to Discipleship is the series. Wednesdays at 6:30 on Zoom. And if you want to be a part of that, just send me an email and we'll get you the invitation to be part of the hour and a half long Zoom Bible study. If you've not had the opportunity to pray Vespers during Lent with us, it will be this Thursday at 5 o'clock on Facebook and YouTube. And it is a recorded service, so you can go to it once it's posted live, once it's posted or made public. You don't have to watch it right at 5 o'clock or be part of pray with it at 5 o'clock. You can pray with it at any time after that, and it'll also be posted on YouTube. So we do encourage you to utilize that. And, of course, the previous weeks of Lent Vespers are on YouTube as well. So if you wanted to do something that you missed last week or the week before, it's available. You can go to YouTube and pray it, at your convenience. Our Holy Week services will be Maundy Thursday and Good Friday, both at 7 o'clock. Both will be in person, and both will be live streamed on Facebook. You're encouraged to come if you can. If not, check us out online. Our Easter services, we are limiting our in-person attendance participation to 50 people. So if you intend to be here in person on Easter Sunday at either 8:30 or 11, you need to contact the church secretary either by phone or by email to sign up with how many people in your party and your family are going to be here so that we can have the space that we need and the separation so that we're continuing to follow CDC guidelines. I think that's all that I have to share with you. So let us prepare our hearts for worship. Thank you. singing, congregational singing is being reintroduced this morning. Yay!
He went over the new songs, Pastor.
Great, thank you.
Yeah, I thought we were.
So, don't be afraid to sing this morning. We're allowed to sing now. Council approved the recommendation sent to them by the worship committee. But we do still need to wear masks, and we need to wear them properly in order to continue singing. Okay? Now, let us prepare our hearts for worship and stand, please. We gather to share in our love of God.
Lord, open our hearts, let us share your goodness.
We gather to share our witness to God's goodness.
Lord, open our eyes for your witness to your service to your people.
We gather to praise God, whose love is eternal.
Lord, open our hearts today to sing your praises.
Oh, everything that is written about the Son of Man by the prophets will be accomplished. For he will be handed over to the Gentiles, and he will be mocked and insulted and spat upon. After they have flogged him, they will kill him, and on the third day he will rise again. But they understood nothing about all these things. In fact, what he said was hidden from them, and they did not grasp what was said. As Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard a crowd going by, he asked what was happening. They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." Then the blind man shouted, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Those who were in front sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he shouted even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and ordered the man to be brought to him. And when he came near, he asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said, "Lord, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Receive your sight. Your faith has saved you." Immediately the man regained his sight and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, praised God. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was. But on account of the crowd, he could not because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, because Jesus was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today." So Zacchaeus hurried down and was happy to welcome Jesus. All who saw it began to grumble and said, "He has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner." Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much." Then Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because he too is the son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, place your words upon my lips and in my heart, that I may proclaim your truth. In our gospel passage this morning, Jesus models for us the luminous kind of vision that ushers in salvation. Having grown up as Christians, most of us have been steeped in Scripture and surrounded by the trappings of Christianity. We tend to presume that we can see ourselves, Jesus, and other people fairly clearly. But these verses, these stories that we heard today, give us pause, because they are all about accepting the smallness of our own vision. They are basically about the courage it takes to recognize that God sees so much more than we do. They are about becoming vulnerable before the very people we have hurt as a result of our own impoverished perspective, so that our mutual transformation can do its painful joy-making work. This passage has three distinct sections, which we will explore one at a time, individually, before considering the selected text as a whole. So the three sections can be identified as follows. Verses 31 to 34 of chapter 18 is Jesus' final prediction of his death and resurrection. Verses 35 to 43, Jesus heals a blind man. And chapter 19, verses 1 to 10, is the story about Jesus and Zacchaeus. So let's look at the first section, Jesus' prediction of his death and resurrection. This is the third time in Luke's gospel that Jesus predicts, or perhaps better, promises his death and resurrection. Each of these predictions could be allowed to stand alone or be considered primarily in their respective settings in the larger narrative of Luke. But it may also be helpful to read the three predictions together as a way of getting the full picture of what it means in the Gospel of Luke for the Son of David to be rejected. In the first prediction of his death and resurrection, Luke's Jesus stresses that his suffering, rejection, and ultimate death will be at the hands of the religious elite in Jerusalem, the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes. This first prediction is set in the immediate context of the question of Jesus' identity. Who do people say that Jesus is? Jesus then declares what his identity means. The people, and in particular the religious, will reject him. In the second prediction, Jesus is far more terse, saying only that he will be betrayed into human hands. And in the final prediction, Jesus says that he will be handed over to the Gentiles, be mocked by them, insulted, spat upon, flogged, and ultimately killed. Notice that when taken together, the three predictions essentially come together to paint a larger and clearer picture. Jesus is rejected by the religious leadership, given into human hands, and finally delivered to the political powers that be, which will mock and insult him. Each piece is but a part of the fuller rejection of the Messiah by humankind. What is more, in this third prediction in Luke, the claim is made that this rejection is so that everything that is written about the Son of Man by the prophets will be accomplished. Moving to the second section of today's passage, we find Jesus healing a blind man. In the first section of our reading this week, Jesus was called the Son of Man. But here, the blind man addresses Jesus as the Son of David. This title shows that the blind man recognized Jesus for who he is, the Anointed One of God. This is somewhat ironic because the disciples still fail to understand what Jesus has already explained to them about what it means to be the Son of Man, that he would be rejected, mocked, killed, and rise again. The disciples fail to see Jesus for who he is. But this blind man sees clearly. And in the blind man who receives his sight because of his insight, there is a model for those who hear this gospel reading. We too are called to set aside our earthly vision and to see Jesus for who he really is. Our only recourse, it would seem, in response to this story, is to take up the blind man's cry, asking Jesus to have mercy on us. Then we move to the third section, the story of Jesus and Zacchaeus. In a sense, the physical stature of Zacchaeus can be seen as an allegory for his cultural status. Zacchaeus is a tax collector. The implication and the expectation in first century Israel would likely have been that Zacchaeus was corrupt, practicing extortion, skimming off the top for himself, and exploiting his fellow Israelites as he collected for Rome. When Jesus goes to join Zacchaeus for dinner, the text states that all who witness this identify Zacchaeus as a sinner. He is a tax collector and rich. Therefore, he must be corrupt. His place in the community, his stature, is truly short. And surprisingly, it is for just one like this that Jesus says that the Son of Man has come. What brings these three distinct sections together? It seems clear that these three stories could each stand alone, at least to some degree. So what does one part of this reading have to do with the other? The key phrase in this text, which ties the three sections together, is the very last line of the text. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost. Section 1 sets up the tension. Jesus is rejected by the people and delivered to the Gentiles. Section 2 introduces the blind man, who presumably is suffering as a result of his sin. He would have been set outside the community as one who's being judged or punished for his sin and who needs to repent. Section 3 brings in Zacchaeus, a tax collector, one of the people who has sold out to the ruling caste and remains outside the in crowd of the community. The force of this story is in its irony. The Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. Those are the ones who are not only found, seen by Jesus, but who in turn see him. That's not a promise postponed until we die. It's a promise for now, to those who have lost jobs and those who no longer find meaning in their work, to those who will change careers many times, and those who feel angry they have to find somebody to blame for everything that has changed. It's a promise to those who have been rejected by society for whatever reason. It's a promise to those who live with a terminal illness, to those who live with depression or other mental illness, for those who live with chronic pain, those who struggle with a learning disability or are differently able. Jesus stops today to meet us wherever we are, proud of our successes or ashamed of our failures. And the people of God said,
Amen. Amen.
God is for us. Then who will then stop us? Then if our God is with us, then who will stand against? Then if our God is for us, then who will then stop us? Then if our God is with us, then who will stand against?
Thank you.
say we want to see Jesus, but too often we are looking in the wrong places, not listening to the right people, not noticing all the grace around us. Let us be vulnerable to God, who will forgive us. God of the New Covenant,
you are the heart which seeks ours, yet we turn away from you time and again. We have so many chances to prepare for others, yet know that we are focused on ourselves too much. We have filled our endless days with the empty calories of fear and worry. We have paid more attention to the ramblings of politicians and celebrities, not to the word of hope. Not to make us a new people. Writing the covenant of grace on our hearts, so we become more forgiving. Write mercy, so we might become more compassionate. Write hospitality, so we might be more inclusive. Help us welcome others into the company of Jesus, as we have been welcomed. Amen.
By the saving love of Jesus Christ, the wisdom and power of God, our sins are forgiven, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lift up your hearts and give thanks to the Lord our God.
We gladly lift up our hearts and give God our praise and thanksgiving.
In the night in which Jesus was betrayed, our Lord took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Jesus draws the whole world to himself. Come to this meal and be fed.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of steadfast love, at this table you gather your people into one body for the sake of the world. Send us in the power of your Spirit that our lives bear witness to the love that has made us new in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for the church, the world, and all in need. You wash us through and through and remember our sin no more. Make your church a community of forgiveness throughout the world. Give your people courage to forgive. Through them, show the world new possibilities. Bless ministries of repentance and reconciliation. Hear us, O God. You promise to write your law on our hearts. Guide citizens throughout the world to shape communities that reflect your mercy, justice, and peace. Give them the creativity to work for the welfare of all. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Jesus calls us to follow him in life and death. Empower this congregation in discipleship. Equip children and teachers of confirmation and youth ministries. Give us your truth and wisdom, and teach us to follow Jesus. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of compassion, we confess, repent, and reject the times when we, as a church and as individuals, have been silent in the face of racial injustice. Heal the hearts of those affected by racism in our community and worldwide. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God, grant comfort to all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, especially thinking of those on our prayer list and those we now name in your presence. Support caregivers who attend to all in need. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We give you thanks for the righteous who have died in faith, especially Mary Kranz, Melvin Lohr, May Erickson, Lena Thomas, Marjorie Kaiser, Robert Bud Brzee, and Eva Louise Titus. Inspire us by their example to proclaim your steadfast love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for peace in the world and for the safety of all military personnel, especially those who have congregational ties. Hear us, O God.
Alarm system will be beginning to be activated today after services, and those of you who need to be trained on how to access it, like turning it off, turning it back on, like altar guild folks, counters, anybody that is going to be needing into the building when nobody else is here, okay, I'll be doing a brief training. It takes like 3 seconds to learn after service. In the narthex, all right, we'll do it single file, you know. but anyhow, if you don't want to do that, if you can't stay today, that's fine. Contact me during the week, and we'll set up a time for you to do that. Either myself or Cindy Anderson will be able to train you on that. Okay? May God bless us, that we may be a blessing. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Waymaker as our